You're a human being first, you're a musician second, and you're a cellist third. Bach always has been a teacher for me. He never gave up on being an experimenter and working on what he loved the most, which was music, composing music, trying different ways to express everything that he wanted to express through sounds. Religious faith is definitely part of his overall form of expression, whether he was writing secular music or writing religious music. And I think he probably looked for consistency in his beliefs and in his actions. So in that sense, I think as a human, he acted with the greatest aspirations toward what was an ideal. My first encounter with the Bach cello suites happened when I was 4 years old. I started the cello after I gave up the violin. I was not successful as a two-year-old violinist, but the cello seemed to fit. In life, we look at patterns, pattern recognition, when something is the same, when something is different. And through that, music became something that I could hold on to because it's a way of looking at something deeply, and then it's another way of looking through music at life. My first attempt of recording all the Bach suites occurred in 1983, exactly 40 years ago. I've been married for 5 years, and I just had my first scoliosis operation. I was in a body cast for 6 months. It was a risk, and the fact that it turned out successfully, I was given sort of a second chance to play, and I was asked, would I record all the Bach suites? Really thinking about that deeply gave me the courage to say, I'm not trying to give the best interpretation of the Bach, assuming there is a best. What I was trying to do is, as a 28-year-old, to do the very best I could in the 3 or 4 days it took to record the 6 suites. So that is an example of best efforts according to one human being at one particular time in that person's life. And I think that's a philosophy that I have tried to hold on to as best as possible throughout my life. And it's also the philosophy that allows me to re-record the suites 2 more times. I think of music as a way of coding knowledge, experience, history. And so if I were to listen to that recording from 1983 versus one that is more recent, all the changes that have happened in me, that have occurred to me in life, it's coded in music. The second version was a giant experiment. It came from reading a book about Bach where he was described as a pictorial composer. Now, I come from a background where it's all about music, it's all about sound. And the fact that Bach was described as someone who actually joined words and sounds in pictures, that blew my mind because it went against what I was taught. So what I did was to say, okay, let's try and think of music as a living material that gets put into the imagination of a living person. You take one piece of music, you give it to someone who is extremely talented and gifted in another form of expression. A filmmaker, a dancer, a garden designer, an ice skater. So in each one of these suites, one person, one artist, spent a year or more living with that piece of music, and then they were invited to express that piece of music in their form. So the first suite became a garden. The second suite was about a filmmaker thinking about architecture. The third suite was a choreography by the Mark Morris dance group. The fourth suite was a film by Adam Egoyan, the great Canadian filmmaker. The fifth suite became a choreography by the great kabuki dancer, Tamasaburo. And the sixth suite, Torvill and Dean turned it into a big ice dance that could only be shown in film because you can never dance on the ice for more than a couple minutes at a time, and it's a 27-minute piece. This is the process that one goes through when you live with something that's living material and what comes out of it, thinking that that's another way of presenting music. Well, you know the saying about, you know, you will do it again and again until you get it right. Well, let's put it that way. You know, in 2018, I'm still trying to get it right. But this time, to get it as right as possible at the age that I'm at. And I think what's changed between my 40s and my 60s is the world. And those changes led me to think about all the parts of the world I didn't know. What got me really interested was exposure to many different kinds of music, but then finding that, in fact, they may sound different, but they're actually deeply connected. And suddenly, that whole world became much more unified in my mind in terms of how very few things kind of spread and evolved. And that experience of those 20 years led me to say, you know what? Bach has taught me so much, but now I know some things that maybe I bring a different lens on the same music. And so what you hear from that version is what's happened during those years. So if we were to think of all six suites as the universe and humans in the universe, then you have an arc that takes you from nature to effort to celebration to kind of assertion to dramatic loss and to finally to transcendence. Within each suite, you have a complete set of different shapes and colors and forms, but there's a consistency because they're all the same dances. One improvised version of that world, and then dances that take you to an extroversion part, to a joyful part, to a meditative part, to a celebratory part, to a communal part. That's it. And it's easily digestible. And it's like looking at nature. A 3-year-old can enjoy it, a 90-year-old can enjoy it. But each completely from their point of view with complete immersion and fulfillment and enjoyment. Bach has been my teacher all throughout my life. Every stage in life, he's taught me something new about something that I didn't know before, but that I can find resonance with.